Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel where skincare is all about progression over perfection because perfection doesn't exist. This shirt is like too big for me, so it's kind of like swamping me up. Like I have no neck, so do excuse it. I just kind of wanted it. I might turn it into a cushion. I was looking through some of my old videos also. the other day, and there are some really shit, like really shit ones. Before I really started taking YouTube seriously, and before I was able to take it as a full-time job and sit down and do my research, you know? And there are some products, some techniques, some things that I really regret recommending that I want to share here, because a lot of the time I still get tagged in these videos and I'm like, oh my god, I hate that product so much now, like I would never use that now. So I kind of want to share that with you now. What I will say at the time is, whilst I loved using skincare, I wasn't as into like the science behind it and trying to find scientists and chemists who really knew what they were talking about, whereas I feel like I know so much now, and I'm so lucky to be able to call a lot of those people my friends. If I do have a problem or a question, I can hop into their DMs and be like, is this true, how does this work, blah blah blah. Back then it was more what I read in the magazine. I was like, oh my god, that sounds really cool, or what I saw on like a blog, or what Men's Health posted. I was like, oh, that's so cool, I need to share that, you know? So let's get straight into it with the very first, very obvious one. That is any DIY product, mask, whatever. Now, I think it's interesting with DIY because there's a lot of cultural links when it comes to DIY recipes. And sometimes you don't always need the science behind something to know if it works or not. And just because there aren't studies there, it doesn't mean it doesn't work. It just means no one's really investing money into study whether bananas are good for your skin, you know, that kind of stuff. But the reason I really regret doing them, as I said, is because it's usually something I saw online or another YouTuber do that I tried once and I was like, this is great. Like, for example, I did a video where I talked about using an egg white mask because it was supposed to make your pores look smaller, and I tried it and it did. But also really dried out my skin. Like I kept using it, and after like a couple months of doing it, my skin was so dry and so tight. It made my skin look good, but very temporarily. And these are things I'll share all the time. Like a turmeric mask I did, which I did wrong. And I know it can have its benefits potentially, but for me, I was like, this doesn't work. It stayed my skin because I did it wrong. And that's the thing when it comes to DIY skincare is no one's telling you the exact amounts. We aren't chemists, you know? We don't really know what to add together to make it work on our skin. A lot of these things aren't gonna work on our skin. They can make surface level changes, but they're not gonna go deeper into our skin because it's food. I also now think it's a waste of money. And a lot of the feedback I get when I talk about how much I hate DIY is people like, what's a cheap alternative? Well, that might have been the case, but skincare is so affordable and accessible now for a lot of people. You can buy products for £2, $2, and they're really decent. They are decent products. But the amount of food you waste making these DIY products, you use all these ingredients to make one mask. It's just a waste. It's such a waste of money. The ordinary, inkless, Boots ingredients. I don't like the brand, but Revolution Skincare. You know, we have some really, really affordable skincare around nowadays. On that note, let's talk about how I regret recommending most drugstore products. Now, bear with me. Drugstore products aren't bad at all, at all. In fact, they have come such a long way from where I used to speak about them 5 years ago. Skincare had a huge boom and more people are interested in investing in skincare. Skincare sells more than makeup nowadays and expected to go on doing so until about 2025, I read in a trend report. It's only going to be selling more, especially in the UK. I feel like 4, 5, even 3 years ago, we didn't have the selection that we do have now. It was very much your basics. It was Nivea, Garnier, Simple, whatever pharmacy, its own brand. And the only decent things actually you had in drugstores was French pharmacy. A lot of the stuff, a lot of the products you found in pharmacies were like your traditional teenage drying out your skin kind of stuff. Bulldog was in there too, they're good too. But along the way, we've seen brands like Pixie come in. We've seen brands like The Ordinary, The Inky List are now in drugstores. I also think in the UK, we don't have places like Sephora. We kind of do, but our pharmacies are different to beauty shops. Like, we don't have like an Ulta. However, Boots is going that way. I went to one in London like a couple of months back, and they're definitely trying to be Sephora. I heard rumors Sephora's come to the UK. You know, we used to have drugstore or Space NK or Selfridges Beauty Hall. There was no kind of real in between, but that's changing now with Boots, especially getting more amazing skincare brands in. We do have that somewhere in between where you could shop for more luxury skincare. They have even have like Kylie Skin in there, or you can go the more affordable route. So, you know, probably the best thing we did have in drugstores was, you know, CeraVe, but at the time that wasn't popular, and French pharmacy, whereas now we have such a huge range of skincare to choose from at an affordable drugstore pharmacy price. The ones that I recommended, Garnier, Biore, all these affordable brands, but weren't necessarily good. Whereas now I feel like affordability and really well-formulated effective skincare is really popular, and that's what brands are aiming for now. So I can feel like I could recommend thousands of products from a drugstore now, you know, from a pharmacy. Whereas back in the day, you have very limited options. The next one is Derma Rolling. I'm gonna be honest, I fucking loved Derma Rolling. I am 99.9% sure it's what helped clear up my dark spots, really made a difference in the overall skin tone, appearance of my skin tone. I loved it. I was doing this for about a year and a half before I stopped doing it, but within 6 months of starting Derma Rolling, nearly all my breakout, post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation was gone. So why do I regret recommending it? Because I regret recommending anything that needs a sanitary environment that should really only be done by trained professionals, despite it working. And I was very clean. I was careful. I prepped. You know, I kept it in like this little plastic thing to keep it safe. I changed the heads. But there are brands out there where you can't even change the head of these derma rollers. They don't know how to properly store the derma roller. They don't give you any cleaning advice or cleaning equipment to go with it. All very far from sanitary. And I've seen people doing this online where you're meant to like lightly roll it over your skin and it causes a little bit of redness. But I've seen people digging and rolling these in their skin and their whole head bleeding because they think it's a different type of facial. When the at-home ones, you're not meant to really get that kind of blood. I regret recommending anything that can cause more harm than good if not done properly. What I will say is this predates my discovery of AHAs, BHAs, acids, actives that could really, really make such a difference in those dark spots. If it was today, I would much rather use AHAs, BHAs, tranexamic acid, azelaic acid, so many different ingredients over derma rolling. And I would probably get a quicker result than I did derma rolling for dark spots and post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. So for derma rolling, it has to be AHAs for me. The whole point for me was to get rid of that post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. So that's exactly what AHA. Teamed with niacinamide, used twice a day. Niacinamide, AHA used a couple of times a week until your skin can tolerate it more, will work perfectly without having to dig needles in your skin unless you're having it done with a professional. A big one that I used to absolutely love, and don't get me wrong, I still love it as a product, the Nature Republic Aloe Vera. It's like 99% gel, so cream, I can't remember, gel. My original K-beauty product. I think this was at the time a lot of people's introduction to K-beauty. This is essentially alcohol and aloe vera gel, which is fine. But I used to use it as a moisturizer and be like, this feels so good on my skin, it's so soothing. What I was getting muddled up then is the difference between the hydration it was giving me and moisturizing, and like, it doesn't make a good moisturizer. I think it makes a really nice soothing, kind of calming, hydrating serum. So yeah, we have aloe barbadenis leaf extract, 92%. So a huge percentage of aloe, which is really nice and soothing, moisturizing. We have alcohol, glycerin, sodium hyaluronate, polyglutamic acid, spearmint extract. Apparently, this makes a really nice hydrating, soothing serum. Is it the best moisturizer ever? No, absolutely not. But people I date daily, I get tagged or commented in this video saying, do you still like this as a moisturizer, or do you recommend this as a moisturizer? No, I don't. I think it's a great hydrating step before a moisturizer. This will not give you, it will make your skin will feel tight, it'll feel dried down. Compared to what we have nowadays, this really is for me, like, I would put this on as like a mask pack, you know, on heavily, cool my skin down, any redness it will help soothe, any burns, or like if you're out in the sun, a great like anti-sun kind of thing. But to call this a moisturizer and recommend it as a moisturizer, I really don't think it's that great anymore. I think back then I hadn't felt hydration. I honestly hadn't felt good hydration in my skin. I was using Lush and that's it. So I wasn't getting any hydrating ingredients. So my skin was tight. and dry. So when I used this and I was getting that hydration, I was like, it's moisturizing, not knowing what the difference was. When it comes to this kind of like lightweight gel moisturizer, you have your choices of gel creams. Glow Recipes Plum Plump Hyaluronic Cream is a really lovely, if you want that deep hydration, is a really nice alternative. If you want something more at the Nature Republic price point, you're looking at the Verst Dew Point Moisturizing Gel Cream. Again, super affordable. It's that gel cream texture where it's lighter than moisturizer, but thicker than an alcohol aloe vera mixture. And you get that really nice deep hydration whilst getting moisture as well. Speaking of Lush, anything from Lush. Now, again, this is one of those things where the products that I used really did work. Coal face? The black soap that had tea tree in and charcoal really, really helped with my oily skin and my breakouts. And Lush was one of the first brands that got me interested in ingredients within skincare. However, even when I worked there, I didn't like 95% of their products. They were shit. It was so bad. The exact products I use though, I just feel like I hit a very comfortable place in my skin. Again, I was seeing results that I'd never seen before because I was moving away from, you know, whatever moisturizer was like £2 down at Boots and kind of looking more into these like essential oils to help with my skin. And I remember actually I started using Cold Face because I saw Lush when I was shopping in the Oracle in Reading. And I walked in and I was like, do you have anything that can help my acne? I had really bad acne back then. And he showed me Cold Face and it did really, 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 really work. However, for me, for the rest of their brand, the essential oils they have in it, the glitter that they now put in everything for some reason, the way these products go moldy after like a month, some of them, if you don't keep them in the fridge, it's all just a no for me. It's all no. Like I actually tried Cold Face more recently and they changed it. It's not that good anymore. I don't know what they did to it, but Lush seemed to have this habit. Why do brands reformulate stuff? Why do brands reformulate really popular like products? I just wish they left it alone. I might still use it if it worked, if it was still good. But for me, this was a no. And thinking about it, it was a soap bar. Like it left my skin squeaky clean. At the time, I thought that was a good sign, but now it makes me cringe, you know? Lush, there is no alternative. Lush is good for your body. We all know that, right? Like the body creams, really, really nice. Shampoos were, I found, very, very drying. Bath bombs, etc. If you can find one that they haven't put fucking glitter in. But for me, Lush for your face is just kind of like a no-go unless you really have landed on something that absolutely works for you. Carry on using it. But for me, it's not for me. My last one is the Etude House Drying Spot Treatment. Here's the thing, is I didn't hate it and it worked for me. However, it's very old fashioned. I have used some drying pastes nowadays that don't dry out the skin to an inch of its life. I think what it was with that particular product is that you dip it in alcohol, then go through to the paste, right, the powder. So it dries out your skin. And whilst yes, this did get rid of my spots, this would dry them out to the point where they'd almost look like scabs and they'd kind of turn into dark spots. I just needed to show some neck. This is too much, this shirt. But at the time I'd be like, oh good, it's drying out my spots. That's a good sign. Like they're drying, they're gone. The best thing to do is dry out your spots. And we all know that's not the case anymore. But again, it's one of those videos where people are like, bought this because of you, or do you recommend this? I'm like, ah. No, I don't still recommend that. Or I make sure I reply to every comment when it refers to old videos where I change my advice. I'm like, no, don't do that anymore. Or no, I don't recommend that. Here's a better alternative. But at the time, I really thought it was working. Cosrx do a really great one, actually, that doesn't dry out as much. But my alternative, my spot treatment, and yes, I know it's got mint in it, but Rosin, their breakout spot treatment, overnight results. I don't say that with a, like, take it lightly. Overnight results. That stuff goes everywhere with me. In case I break out, I don't care, because I know if I put that spot treatment on, for me, it gets rid of the spot overnight. If it's a huge aggressive one, under the skin, not so much. Surface, where you can see the whitehead, it's going red, it will get rid of it for me overnight. I love it so much. So there we go. Let me know if you've used any of these, or if, like, things that you bought on my... Tell you what, tell me something that you bought on my recommendation that you absolutely hated in the comments down below. You can watch some more skincare reviews here, some general light entertainment here, and I'll see you over there.